It's Good Friday. Not exactly a good day, a very painful day. Perhaps good for you and me in the sense of the sacrifice Jesus is making for us here upon this altar. This table that has become an altar of his sacrifice, his blood shed for you and for me, for the sins of the whole world. He has made himself a sacrifice once and for all. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, hear these words of Scripture. We like sheep have all gone astray. We've turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Christ the Lord became obedient unto death, even death on a cross. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we've sinned in thought and word and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as we love ourselves. We pray you of your mercy, forgive us all that is in the past. Grant that we may serve you in newness of our life to the glory of your name. Amen. The Lord be with you and also with you. Almighty God, look graciously, we pray, on this your family for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and given into the hands of sinners and to suffer death upon the cross, who now lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
The psalm this morning is Psalm number 22. My God, why have you forsaken me and are so far from my cry and from the words of my distress? O my God, I cry in the daytime, but you do not answer. By night as well, but I find no rest. Yet you are the Holy One, enthroned upon the praises of Israel. Our forefathers put their trust in you. They trusted, and you delivered them. They cried out to you and were delivered. They trusted in you and were not put to shame. But as for me, I am a worm and no man, scorned by all and despised by the people. All who see me laugh me to scorn. They curl their lips and wag their heads, saying, "He trusted in the Lord. Let him deliver him. Let him rescue him if he delights in him." Yet ye are he who took me from my mother's womb and kept me safe upon my mother's breast. I have been entrusted to you ever since I was born. You were my God when I was still in my mother's womb. Be not far from me, for trouble is near, and there is no help. Many young bulls encircle me. Strong bulls of Bashan surround me. They open wide their jaws at me like a ravening and roaring lion. I am poured out like water. All my bones are out of joint. My heart within my breast is melting wax. My mouth is dried out like a potsherd. My tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. And if you have laid me in the dust of the grave, packs of dogs close me in, and gangs of evildoers encircle around me. They pierce my hands and my feet. I can count all my bones. They stare and gloat over me. They divide my garments among them. They cast lots for my clothing. Be not far away, O Lord. You are my strength. Hasten to help me. Save me from the sword, my life from the power of the dog. Save me from the lion's mouth, my wretched body from the horns of wild bulls. I will declare your name to my brethren. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. Praise the Lord, you that fear him. Stand in awe of him, O offspring of Israel. All you of Jacob's line, give glory, for he does not despise nor abhor the poor in their poverty, neither does he hide his face from them. But when they cry to him, he hears them. My praise is of him in the great assembly. I will form my vows in the presence of those who worship him. The poor shall eat and be satisfied, and those who seek the Lord shall praise him. May your heart live forever. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations shall bow before him. The kingship belongs to the Lord. He rules over the nations. To him alone, all who sleep in the earth bow down in worship, and who go down to the dust fall before him. My soul shall live for him. My descendants shall serve him. They shall be known as the Lord's forever. They shall come and make known to a people yet unborn the saving deeds that he has done. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The New Testament lesson for Good Friday is from the book of Hebrews, chapter 10, verses 16 to 25. This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law in their hearts, and I will write them on their minds. He also adds, I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more. Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. Therefore, my friends, since we have confidence to enter the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us approach with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who has promised is faithful. And let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John. After Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to a place where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers together with police from the chief priests and the Pharisees, and they came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen, came forward and asked them, "For whom are you looking?" They answered, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus replied, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they stepped back and fell to the ground. Again he asked them, "For whom are you looking?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. So if you are looking for me, let these men go." This was to fill the word that he had spoken, "I did not lose a single one of those whom you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword back into its sheath. Am I not to drink the cup the Father has given me?" So the soldiers, their officer, and the Jewish police arrested Jesus and bound him. First they took him to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jews that it was better to have one person die for the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest, but Peter was standing outside at the gate. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out, spoke to the woman guarded the gate, and brought Peter in. The woman said to Peter, "You are not also one of this man's disciples, are you?" He said, "I am not." Now the slaves and the police had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing round it and warming themselves. Peter also was standing with them and warming himself. Then the high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. Jesus answered, "I have spoken only to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple, where all the Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who heard what I said to them. They know what I said." When he had said this, one of the police standing nearby struck Jesus on the face, saying, "Is that how you answer the high priest?" Jesus answered, "If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?" Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They asked him, "You are not also one of his disciples, are you?" He denied it and said, "I am not." One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked, "Did I not see you in the garden with him?" Again, Peter denied it, and at that moment, the cock crowed. Then they took Jesus from Caiaphas to Pilate's headquarters. It was early in the morning. They themselves did not enter the headquarters so as to avoid ritual defilement and to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" They answered, "If this man were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you." Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law." The Jews replied, "We are not permitted to put anyone to death." This was to fulfill what Jesus had said when he indicated the kind of death he was to die. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." Pilate asked him, "What is truth?" After he had said this, he went out to the Jews again and told them, "I find no case against him, but you have a custom that I release someone for you at the Passover. Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?" They shouted in reply, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Now Barabbas was a bandit. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. And the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and put it on his head, and they dressed him in a purple robe. They kept coming up to him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," and striking him on the face. Pilate went out again and said to them, "Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no case against him." So Pilate came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Here is the man." When the chief priests and the police saw him, they shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no case against him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to that law he ought to die because he was claimed to be the Son of God." Now when Pilate heard this, he was more afraid than ever. He entered his headquarters again and asked Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. Pilate therefore said to him, "Do you refuse to speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you and power to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no power over me unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin." From then on, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out, "If you release this man, you are no friend of the emperor. Everyone who claims to be a king sets himself against the emperor." When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus outside and sat on the judge's bench at a place called the Stone Pavement, or in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation for the Passover, and it was about noon. He said to the Jews, "Here is your king." They cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate asked them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but the emperor." Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross by himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus between them. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. Then the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write 'the King of the Jews,' but 'this man said, I am the King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They also took his tunic. Now the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see who will get it." This was to fulfill what the scripture says, "They divided my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots." And that is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there. So they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Since it was the day of preparation, the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because that Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified so that you may also believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occurred so that the scripture might be filled. None of his bones shall be broken. And again, another passage of scripture says, they will look on the one whom they have pierced. After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one because of his fear of the Jews, asked Pilate to take him away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission, so he came and removed his body. Nicodemus, who had at first come to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and wrapped it with the spices in linen cloths, according to the burial custom of the Jews. Now there was a garden in the place where he was crucified. And in that garden there was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And so, because it was the Jewish day of preparation, and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there.
I speak to you in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Justice. Justice is one of the key parts today of what Jesus is facing. In his case, it's injustice. Two Canadians have been on trial in China. They are tit for tat with the government of China because they were taken as Canadians, almost like a hostage to the fact that a Chinese national had been arrested on a warrant from the United States here in Canada and is still facing continual trial. Those two Canadians have for 2 years been put in cells that have no windows, and they have just holes for toilets. They've had a really rough time, and there is no sense of justice that's being offered. Today also, the police who took the life of George Floyd, the African-American gentleman who was killed, are going on trial. That also will be a test of the justice system to see where justice goes. Police usually have the upper hand because they say that they will simply do their job, be doing their job. Justice is such a hard thing to define, and it's just not going to be there for Jesus because his fate's already been decided. Long before he's arrested and taken in the Garden of Gethsemane, long before he's taken before the chief priests, long before he gets to Herod and then eventually to Pilate, his fate's already been written. The authorities see him as a troublemaker. He disrupts the peace that is found between the priestly caste and the temple, the Roman authorities, and Herod, who has to run Galilee. They see him as someone who incites the people, who endangers that nice, quiet peace. The Pax Romana, the Romans called it, the peace that their empire had. And he was a volatile force. He upset the city. He upset what was all around. And there was a great disappointment from all of the people as well. So not only does he not have the people behind him because they wanted a king, but now he has to face the fact the temple authorities feel he has to die. Herod will not step in. Pontius Pilate will simply ask what is truth, because he can find nothing wrong. So there's an evil that's going to be done today. And evil is very palpable. Evil is very real in the lives of people. Sometimes it seems like we just forget along the way to be fair and to be just. But that also can be the evil within us that just sprouts up to say, I want what I want, and whatever price has to be paid will be paid, even in human blood. So many people have already died in Myanmar, trying so hard to fight against the military takeover of that country. It has been a brutal, brutal ending to so many lives as the military continue to fire into the civilians that are simply protesting. That is also an evil when you turn against your own people and kill them left, right, and center. What evil has he done? Pilate asked. What evil has he done? And it remains unanswered. Pontius Pilate was a politician. Politicians never seem to accept blame. We know that in the recent riots in the United States, where the Capitol building was stormed in Washington, D.C., that somehow the President of the United States at that time, who knew he was on his way out, he'd been defeated in the election, cried to them and said, "Go, you know, we'll march, we'll go down there and get justice finally." And he inspired it. But then he said later, it wasn't his fault. He never really inspired it. They were already set on doing it. It wasn't his fault. It wasn't his fault, like some kind of Bart Simpson on the Simpsons television show, where Bart Simpson always says, "Not my fault, I didn't do it. Well, politicians do it. They say things that they shouldn't say, and they do things they shouldn't do. And it ends up, unfortunately, costing people's lives and costing people's feelings about the future of democracy. They deflect blame to other people. So Pontius Pilate was deflecting blame. Herod was deflecting blame. The temple authorities simply said, "Well, the crowd is the one shouting. We're not shouting to crucify him. We have nothing to do with it," although they probably inspired the crowd to cry out for the crucifixion of Jesus. Jesus was aware. The clock was ticking away slowly but surely. He knew the end was coming. He knew the end was approaching very quickly. He'd been betrayed. He had been abandoned. He had been unjustly brought before courts and unjustly accused. He was now facing the death sentence. It used to be only condemned prisoners knew that the hour of their death. There were times, I know, when I worked in a jail, that they would look back upon the times where people were still executed. Those days, people knew when they lined up somehow, like a movie, what's called The Green Mile, where they would be affecting and facing death. But nowadays, we also have assisted death. So many people do know the hour of their death, not just criminals. They know when they are going to die because they worked it out with their families, their friends, and their doctors. They know that they're facing death because they simply cannot live with pain, or they can't live with what they're facing, the inability to have any quality of life. And it's a tough decision, but it's a decision that they do make. Jesus knew the hour of his death. He knew it was coming very, very quickly. For a man who loved life, it was even more difficult. As I said yesterday, he went to the Garden of Gethsemane in tears, facing the fact that he wished he did not have to die. He would love to have it taken away from him. And yet he was obedient to God. The death of Jesus is an obedience to his mission, which is to die for you and for me, to shed his blood for you and for me, to say, "I love you this much," and stretch his arms out on the cross, to say, "You're that important. I'm dying for you, to reconcile you to God. What Adam first was disobedient to, I'm obedient to. I am here for you. I am here to mend that division between God and humanity." Jesus loved food and friends and crowds and all those good things. And Good Friday becomes for us a horror story. How much of a horror story? I don't know if you've ever seen Mel Gibson's The Passion of the Christ. It is a brutal film, and I could not look at it constantly. I just couldn't. It's blood-soaked. It's just brutal. And at one point, I found myself tearing up, because what we did to Jesus Christ, what we did to God with us, is unthinkable, is unbelievable, is beyond measure of what humanity should be capable of. But we are capable of it. That's the sad part. We are capable of slaughter and murder and pain and torture. We are capable of all those things. We are reminded every year of the horrors of the Nazis, what they did to so many people in concentration camps. We're reminded that Stalin put millions of people to death. We're reminded that Pol Pot took the lives of nearly half of the Cambodian people. We are reminded of so much that is taken away in human life. But the death of Jesus Christ says we cannot let inhumanity run our human lives. We can't let our inhuman instincts, that id in the back of our mind which feels threatened and angry and vicious and hard and evil, we can't let that run our lives. The power of love is the power of Jesus Christ to overcome all of that evil, all of that ugliness, all of that horror that we see on Good Friday. We see it still in places like Boulder, Colorado the other day, where people who are innocent standing in a supermarket are gunned down. We see it in North Vancouver the other day, where a man with a knife ran through and killed one person and wounded many others with a knife. The assaults upon life itself, the assaults upon our humanity itself. We're meant to learn from what happened on Good Friday. We're meant to learn man's inhumanity to man. We're meant to learn that our humanity is more important, that beyond death and life, there is a love that reaches out in the midst of horror. The blood-soaked being, the horror of Good Friday, should remind us of that time and again. Jesus took it all in. He took it all in, from being whipped and beaten and spat on and made fun of and derided and taunted on the cross. And as he's hanging there for 3 hours, taking in all of the hate and all of the anger and all the frustration of people around him. And yet, what does he say? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And he was right. We didn't know what we were doing. But every time human life is taken in vicious, horrible ways, we do know what we're doing. And we can't allow it to happen again. Christianity is more than just a faith. It's a way of life. It's a way of saying life is precious. Every human life is precious. And in the midst of a pandemic, we've got to work together to share our humanity, to be human, to recognize that there are inhuman people out there who want to destroy. And our message is a message of peace and love and understanding, and we have to stand up for it. In a world where there is anger and frustration and hate, we have to stand on the side of right, stand on the side of Jesus Christ. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. But we do know what we do if we don't stop it, if we don't hold up our humanity and our faith in Jesus, if we don't hold up the cross and say, never again, never again. We can't allow this to happen. Ever again. This Good Friday, take time to remember your humanity. And remember, we have a message of love to share. And the Christian faith is meant for something, not just for praying, but for doing. And remembering, life is precious. And the life we took was more precious than anything that we ever have had. Amen. Thank you.
Dear people of God, our Heavenly Father sent his Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved, that all who believe in him might be delivered from the power of sin and death, and become heirs with him of eternal life. Let us pray for the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church of Christ throughout the world, for its unity in witness and service, for all bishops and other ministers and the people whom they served, for Rosilla, our bishop, and all the peoples of this diocese, for Terry and Janet, and all Christians in this community, that the Lord will confirm his church in faith, increase it in love, and preserve it in peace.
Almighty and ever-living God, by your Spirit, the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified. Receive our supplications and prayers, which we offer before you, for all members of your holy church, that in our vocation and ministry we may truly and devotedly serve you, through our Lord Jesus Christ and Savior. Amen.
Let us pray for all nations and peoples of the earth, and for those in authority among them. For Elizabeth, our Queen, and all the royal family, for Justin, the Prime Minister, and for the government of this country, for Doug, the Premier of this province, and the members of the legislature, for Jeff and the other mayors of the municipalities in this area and those who serve with them on the councils, for all who serve the common good, that by God's help they may seek justice and truth and live in peace and concord.
Almighty God, kindle, we pray, in every heart the true love of peace, and guide with your wisdom those who take counsel for the nations of the earth, that justice and peace may increase until the earth is filled with the knowledge of your love, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray for all who suffer and are afflicted in body or in mind, for the hungry and homeless, the destitute and the oppressed, and all who suffer persecution or prejudice, for the sick, the wounded, and the handicapped, for those in loneliness, fear, and anguish, for those who face temptation, doubt, and despair, for the sorrowful and bereaved, for prisoners and captives, and those in mortal danger, that God in his mercy will comfort and relieve them, and grant them the knowledge of his love, and stir up in us the will and patience to minister to their needs.
Gracious God, the comfort of all who sorrow, the strength of all who suffer, hear the cry of those in misery and need. In their afflictions, show them your mercy, and give us, we pray, the strength to serve them. For the sake of him who suffered for us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray for all who have not received the gospel of Christ, for all who have not heard the words of salvation, for all who have lost their faith, for all whose sin has made them indifferent to Christ, for all who actively oppose Christ by word or deed, for all who are enemies of the cross of Christ and persecutors of his disciples, for all who in the name of Christ have persecuted others, that God will open their hearts to the truth and lead them to faith and obedience.
Merciful God, creator of the peoples of the earth and lover of souls, have compassion on all who do not know you, as you are revealed in your Son, Jesus Christ. Let your gospel be preached with grace and power to those who have not heard it. Turn the hearts of those who resist it, and bring home to your fold those who have gone astray, that there may be one flock under one shepherd, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Let us commit ourselves to God and pray for the grace of a holy life, and with all who have departed this life and have died in the peace of Christ, and those whose faith is known to God alone, we may be accounted worthy to enter into the fullness of the joy of our Lord and receive the crown of life in the day of resurrection.
O God, of unchangeable power and eternal light, look favorably on your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery. By the effectual working of your providence, carry out in tranquility the plan of salvation. Let the whole world see and know that things which were cast down are being raised up, and things which had grown old are now being made new, that all things are being brought to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
This is the wood of the cross on which hung the Savior of the world. Come, let us worship. Is it nothing to you, all you who pass by? Look and see if there is any sorrow like my sorrow, which was brought upon me, which the Lord inflicted on the day of his fierce anger. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one, have mercy upon us. O my people, O my church, what have I done to you, or in what have I offended you? Testify against me. I led you forth from the land of Egypt and delivered you by the waters of baptism. but you have prepared a cross for your Savior. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one, have mercy upon us. I led you through the desert 40 years and fed you with manna. I brought you through the tribulation and penitence and gave you my body, the bread of heaven. But you have prepared a cross for your Savior. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one, have mercy upon us. What more could I have done for you that I have not done? I planted you, my chosen and fairest vineyard. I made you the branches of my vine. And when I was thirsty, you gave me vinegar to drink and pierced me with a spear, the side of your Savior. Holy God, holy and mighty one, holy and immortal one, have mercy upon us. I went before you in a pillar of cloud, and you have led me to the judgment hall of Pilate. I scourged your enemies and brought you to a land of freedom, but you have scourged, mocked, and beaten me. I gave you the water of salvation from the rock, but you have given me gall and left me to thirst. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one, have mercy upon us. I gave you a royal scepter and bestowed the keys to the kingdom, but you have given me a crown of thorns. I raised you on high with great power, but you have hanged me on the cross. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one, have mercy upon us. My peace I gave, which the world cannot give, and washed your feet as a sign of my love. But you draw the sword to strike in my name and seek high places in my kingdom. I offered you my body and blood, but you scatter and deny and abandon me. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one, have mercy upon us. I sent the Spirit of truth to guide you, and you close your hearts to the Counselor. I pray that all may be as one in the Father and me, but you continue to quarrel and divide. I call you to go and bring forth fruit, but you cast lots for my clothing. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one, have mercy upon us. I gathered you into the tree of my chosen Israel, and you turned on them with persecution and mass murder. I made you joint heirs with them of my covenants, but you made them scapegoats for your own guilt. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one, have mercy upon us. I came to you as the least of your brothers and sisters. I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not clothe me. Sick, and in prison, and you did not visit me. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal one, have mercy upon us. O Savior of the world, by your cross and precious blood, you have redeemed us. Save us and help us, we humbly beseech you, O Lord.
Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Almighty and eternal God, send down your abundant blessing, Lord, upon your people who have devoutly recalled the death of your Son in the sure and certain hope of the resurrection. Grant us pardon and peace, and bring us comfort that our faith may grow stronger each day and eternal salvation be assured. We ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Philippians chapter 2. Christ became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen.